Design patterns are for the unserious, and in general, focusing on tactics and how-tos and specific recipes is for the unserious. And you know, I really do mean that. Let me start by acknowledging though that there's some cases where design patterns are super useful. They tend to come in super, super handy when you're making a library or a framework. For example, the Android SDK, in its implementation of RecyclerViews, when you're scrolling and you see, in any app where you have to scroll, you're gonna see a recycler view, where the view that just left the screen gets recycled and moved to the bottom, and then new content gets put into it so that you don't have to recompute the layout and reinflate all the objects that you needed to inflate to render it in the beginning. So the way that they implement that is with the adapter pattern, and it's a fantastic implementation. Like, it makes it super easy for them to give you that hook. So design patterns are useful. However, they're neither necessary nor sufficient to produce good software, especially if you're not writing libraries. If you're writing libraries, I would say they're probably necessary in many cases. But if you're just writing software that's not a library for other people to consume, they're neither necessary nor sufficient. Writing good software is very context dependent, and it's like any other complex skill. Like, if you think about sports, if you think about basketball, right? Being a good programmer is kind of like being a good basketball player. There's lots of different ways to be a good basketball player, right? You have like somebody like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, who was an incredible center. And you have somebody like Magic Johnson, who was like a super tall point guard. But then you have other point guards like the Parker guy from the Spurs. I forget his first name. You have shooting guards that are great. You have power forwards like Charles Barkley, a short power forward that could rebound and make shots. Great player. Dennis Rodman, you know, couldn't make a shot to save his life. But the point differential that whenever he was on the court, the opposite team was like minus 14 points or something like that. So just lots of different ways to be a good basketball player. And none of them come down to choosing specific little plays or specific little types of shots every time. Okay. A lot of middling developers who are like in their third or fourth year of their career, they think that everything is about design patterns. So they think that software is automatically good if he uses design patterns. So they'll write a backend where each endpoint would be like 20 lines of code, and they blow it up to 200 lines because they have to have a service and a repository and a model class and a bunch of bullshit that doesn't accomplish anything. And they do that because of the imposter syndrome that they have. They want to feel like they're good developers, and they look for an answer to, hey, how do I be a good developer? And then there's no shortage of people espousing the design patterns as a way to be a good developer. There's no shortage of people telling you a little 10-step recipe to be a good developer. Hey, look, just memorize the design patterns and apply them, and you're going to be a good developer. That's bullshit. That's like saying that if you memorize the pick and roll play and you memorize every style of shooting, that you're going to be a good basketball player. Hey, look, you actually have to make the shots. You actually have to score. You have to make the good plays in basketball. It's a complex, dynamic thing that goes on in real time, just like engineering. Engineering is a thing that goes on in real time. You get requirements, and you're servicing a business in real time. What makes a good developer, there's lots of ways to be a good developer. For example, you can be good at prototyping. You can be a very fast prototyper. You can be good at refactoring and making large, messy code bases maintainable. You can be good at figuring out how to turn very complex requirements and service them very simply because of your product mindset. There's lots of ways that you can be good. None of them boil down to tactics that you read from a book and apply in a step-by-step manner, okay? Let's look at a tangible example. This is an example from the real world. There was a time where I worked at a place. We had a checkout page, and the client fetched the program from the server, then rendered the pricing or whatever, and then it gave you, you know, a box to put in a promo code and a box to put in your address. If you put in the promo code first, the client has to update in real time, right? So like, if you put in a promo code and you say apply, you have to show the discount right away. So that was one potential thing that could happen. The user could put in a promo code, and then you have to basically send a request to the backend to, hey, look, here's the program that I have, apply this promo code to it and give me back what the price should be, and then you render that. Then they put in their address. Depending on their address, they might have state tax. They might have sales tax in their state. So you will have to send a request to the backend. Here's the program and here's the address. Give me the price after taxes. And then you would have to resend the request for the promo code to apply it to the price after taxes. And then you would have the final number. So there's a lot of complex logic here, depending on the order in which operations occur. And hopefully, I didn't do a too terrible of a job butchering that explanation. So I looked at that and I saw all that client complexity, and there was a lot of duplicated code because, you know, after the tax, you have to still apply the promo code type of thing. And also, like, there's some states that have no taxes. So, like, there's some states where the tax is zero, and then, like, in that case, you break out without calling the promo code endpoint, and it was just quite a mess. So what I decided to do was I created just like you could call this a facade pattern. I created a new endpoint that just took everything that the client could have, you know, the program, the state, the address that they're in, the promo code, if any, just pass everything that you have, and I'll give you back everything that you need to display. You could consider this the facade pattern. And then this facade actually did the complex logic. So I just moved the complex logic from the client to the server. And in the server, it was, you know, integration testable. It was just like way better. It was a way better place for it to live. Still not that big of an improvement though. What if, and okay, and let me go into a little bit more detail into each of these things. So program, the client was calling a program endpoint, and the program endpoint ended up calling a program model object, like one of those thick models that also has logic in it. And you could get full price math. Then the client ended up would call a tax calculator endpoint, and the tax calculator endpoint had an object behind it that when the server started up, it would load and cache tax rates from states. You would only do that at server startup time. And then you could pass it a program and it would compute the taxes. Similarly, the promo code, check the database for the promo code to see if it was already used. And then you could pass it a program to apply a promo code to it, and it would return you the information. So then I did the facade thing. The code was actually much simpler after all that because it always got the same sets of inputs. So there was only one execution flow. Obviously, I didn't call from here. I didn't call the endpoints. I called the model objects, like get full price. But what if you didn't make this design decision of passing the program to tax calculator and passing the program to promo code? What if you just changed everything? You just changed your interfaces, and then there were like these objects were very thin functions instead, just to fetch a program from the database, fetch tax rate from memory given a state, and fetch whether a promo code is valid or not given the actual code. Then you would need a facade pattern. You would just write simple imperative logic in this place right here, and there's no need for a design pattern. The thing that design patterns assume is that their design patterns look at something like this, right? And then they give you a tool to make it a little bit better. But they treat code as if it were a city. Code is not a city. In a city, you need to like build on top, and you need to, like, if you make a traffic pattern mistake or something, I don't know anything about city planning, but like, let's say that you make a mistake with traffic pattern and you need to build another bridge and you need to build a walkway between two buildings. You can build on top to fix issues because you're not going to knock down a bunch of buildings. But in code, you can knock down all the buildings. That's the thing that makes design patterns so rarely necessary. The only time that they're necessary is if you want to improve things a little bit and you're under time constraints, or maybe as an intermediate step. Right? So if we do this first, now the client works a certain way, and now we don't have to change the client to do the final refactor where we get rid of all these stupid objects and all these stupid inversion control tactics where we're passing a program to a tax calculator to get a tax rate back, and we're passing a program to promo code. Those objects could be way thinner. This method right here could just fetch the promo code, fetch the tax, and fetch the program from the database and do all the logic right there and not have to pass stuff around anywhere. So there's nothing to be a facade for. The type of insight and the type of willingness to simplify is, in my opinion, a lot of what goes into being a good developer. It's not about, you know, just applying design patterns mindlessly. And it's not about following rules for how to write code. It's about being effective. It's about being correct. It's about implementing a lot of functionality with a little bit of code and doing well by your users fast, maintainably, and safely. And design patterns can sometimes help with that. Often they don't. Often they just get in the way because they anchor your thinking on the design pattern instead of letting you think about what buildings you can tear down. All right, that's it for today. I hope that was informative or at least food for thought. Let me know what you think in the comments. Always welcome civil debates. Please remember to like and subscribe to the channel, and I'll see y'all next time.